Ali Jamieson, I'm from New Zealand and I'm here to present the Upstage project. We've just done a workshop earlier today where we went through some of how it works, so I'm going to talk more about how we made it and why and what it is. What you're seeing up here on the screen is the audience version of Upstage, and hopefully my colleague Suzanne Fuchs, who is actually in Indonesia at the moment, is going to be doing things there, but she's having some network problems. But she can hear us on Skype. So, first of all, I'm not a programmer, and I'm also not a visual artist. My background is in theatre, and in the 90s I was involved in web development and doing things in the internet that led to me discovering that people were using the internet for creative purposes, and that one of the things I found was people who were creating performances in IRC channels and chat rooms. And so I got involved in that around the end of the 90s and kind of got a bit hooked on it, and started working with people in the States called Desktop Theatre, doing live performance in a graphical chat room called The Palace. And at some point in our work, we were using iVisit and The Palace and any other tools that we could get our hands on for nothing. But they were always limited in ways that were really annoying for us as performers. For example, you couldn't necessarily change your nickname once you'd created an identity, because they were, for chat, they were concerned with people being trusted as the same person. Whereas in performance, you want to be different people. And so we started to think that it would be really great if we could make our own software for this. And we also were running into problems such as The Palace was stopped being developed in 2000. And we were still using it up to about 2005, even though it was no longer being developed. And it was becoming more and more difficult to make it work on upgraded operating systems. And things like this were making us as artists feel really frustrated with the tools that were available to us. And we were looking for other environments that could do what we wanted to do and not finding them. Then in 2003, we managed to get a very small amount of money and employed a programmer to make what we wanted. And we said to him, we want to have something that is cross-platform. It has to work on everything. We don't want people to have to download it. We want them to be able to go to it on the internet without any barriers. It has to be able to work over dial-up, because some of us are still on dial-up. And we want it to be really easy for audiences to use, because when we were working with things like The Palace, the audience had to also download and install The Palace and know how to use it, and then the audience were also on stage with us. So we wanted to create an environment where the audience were involved and participating, but not at the same level as the players. So we gave Douglas Bagnall all of these dreams that we had as artists, and we had no idea whether we were being realistic or not. But he said, yeah, I think we can do it, and I'll write it in Python, and we'll use Flash to serve it to the browser. And it'll work in a web browser, and it'll work on Mac and Linux and Windows and everything. And he made it. And we've been using Upstage since 2004, and that was the first version. The second version was launched in 2007. And since 2006, we've had teams of students at Auckland University of Technology who are computer programming students, and in their final year, they have to work on a real-world project, and they started using Upstage as one of their real-world projects in 2006, and since then, every year, we've had teams of 3 to 5 students that roll over, and that really has been the only way that we've continued this project. We've had one... Oh, that one's going to sleep. We've had one other grant. So in the 7 years of Upstage's existence, we've had two grants, and they were both really, really small. So Suzanne is not appearing here, unfortunately. I'll just see if she's telling me in Skype. No. She's at a residency in Indonesia and working on a Vodum connection that is, I think, just as reliable as the Wi-Fi upstairs. So never mind. Unfortunately, you won't see things happening here. But basically, what Upstage lets us do is, as artists who are located in different places, we can collaborate in real time to make performance events, which I call cyberformance. We upload various media beforehand that can be animations, illustrations, photographic media. We upload them as backdrops, avatars and props, and the avatars can move around and speak using text-to-speech, so there are computerised voices. We can have audio files, webcam images, and real-time drawing on the stage. So it's quite a lot of different things that we're combining, which is partly why I'm here at a graphics meeting, because a lot of what we do is graphical work, and there are a lot of people involved in it now who are visual artists who are looking at a way to move their practice into the internet and into live performance. So it's as an environment for collaboration with artists across different disciplines, it's quite an exciting place to work. But I thought it might be interesting just to talk a little bit about being an artist involved in an open source software development, because a few people touched on it yesterday. Someone was saying that there seems to be quite a gap between the artists and the programmers. I don't know how any other open source projects work, but the way that Upstage has worked is perhaps a bit like Pure Dine. We've come to it as artists with a need, and we've said, this is what we want, can you do it? And most of the time it's yes, and a lot of the time it's, well, we could if we had lots and lots of money. Very rarely have the programmers said, no, we actually can't do what you want. But as artists involved in the running of this, or for me in particular, over the last 7 years, I've had to learn about, for example, we use SourceForge as a repository for it and as a bug tracker and as things like that. So I've had to come to understand how things like this work, and learning about agile software development and sprints and all of this, and reading the technical documentation that the students provide, which is quite often needs a whole lot more work before we can actually put it out there. So now with... Oh, Suzanne's trying to hear us. Now that we've been going for 7 years, we've built up quite a big user base. We've got a festival happening every year. This is the fourth year, and we have 19 performances that will be happening on the 10th of October. They're 20-minute performances created by artists all around the world in Upstage. And there's a mailing list with a few hundred people and a very small developer pool. And one of the things that, as an artist who all my experience of open source is from having to do whatever we need to do to get it done, one of the things I don't know how to do is engage programmers. So if there's anyone out there who's interested or who can give me advice about how to get people involved... We have this high turnover of students who are fantastically enthusiastic about it. I think it's the most interesting project that they get offered at university. I think everything else is quite dry, and we're actually a lot of fun for them to work with. So they're great, but they're there for a year and then they're gone. And so we have a big problem with keeping track of everything. And our original programmer is still involved, but he is so much in demand for other work that he gets paid for that we're at the bottom of the priority pile. So at the moment we have a lot of things that the students have developed that we haven't been able to implement because we haven't been able to integrate everything into the actual code that's on SourceForge. Now Suzanne's appearing from Indonesia. She's using a webcam there, which is we use Motion JPEG, to add webcam images in, and they can be as big as you want or as small as you want. Hi, Suzanne. Oh, there's Scotia as well. Okay. We're actually almost finished, I think. We're probably about to get the 1 minute. Almost. Okay, and we have no sound on it, so you can't hear the... It uses festival text-to-speech to make the voices for the avatars, but you won't hear it now. If anybody's interested in finding out more about it, you can join the mailing list, and we have open sessions online where we show people how to use it. And we've got the festival coming up in October, so that's a really good way to see it. And also there are some video excerpts on the website that you can have a look at, and I'll leave some little postcards outside so you can get the web address and everything. But it's upstage.org.nz. Whew.